Welcome to 2022. Hard to imagine another year has passed. We're blessed and certainly rejoicing in God's good hand at work in our lives. And as I record this message for this coming Sunday, you can see the last portion of our Christmas decoration because the truth is that now we're moving into a new year with new opportunities, new moments to share in God's great plan for our church and for our lives. And I'm thrilled more than ever in the midst of everything that we face to know that we as a church have maintained our vision. We've maintained our focus. We have accomplished what God intended, and we have seen some great things to come out of it. We've been wise and safe. We've been called and committed. We have been focused and faithful. That is what you would want from any church. And that's why you're watching this, because you're a part of the One Heart family. You're a part of my life, and you're certainly a part of the life of all those who call One Heart home. And so I'm delighted to have this opportunity to be able to open up a new year inside of God's Word. And today I want to look at how to glimpse into the future. Because you think about it now, there are people that make all kinds of predictions. Many of the predictions we hear never come true. They're always cast out there for some reason, but the truth is they don't carry us forward. They don't move us in a direction, because the truth is that God is the one who's ordered our steps. God is the one who has planned a future for us. And it's interesting, because today I want us to take a moment to glimpse into the future and to look at a minor prophet who, at the moment he writes, is trying to figure out what is God up to and how is he at work. And as a result of that, he begins to find God shaping his vision for life and for purpose, and certainly gives him an opportunity to be able to experience God's very best. And so today, as you think about that, we glimpse in the future looking at the minor prophet Habakkuk. So you may take you a moment to find that in your Bible. It's only three chapters, but they are profound, and they connect us into what was going on at that time. And I think it'll be encouraging to you as we look at this today, because here's what you need to realize. We all have to answer a question. How do we see the future? In other words, do we see the future as bright and meaningful and powerful? Do we look at it as an opportunity to know that God has something for us? I know for me personally, I've never been more excited. Thankful for God's faithfulness, thankful for the way he works in our fellowship, thankful how he works in hearts, thankful how he works in my own heart. I'm grateful for my family, grateful for the privilege of being able to serve the Lord with a big portion of my entire family here every Sunday. And so God is good. He's given us a great future, and you should see it in the same way in light of what it is God has in store for you. When you start thinking about it, a vision-based future, one that God gives us, is one that leads to victory. In other words, if I know God's got something going for me, he's going to move me forward. And I'm going to tell you, when we started the COVID season almost 2 years ago, I can remember the Lord kept burning into my mind and heart, be better than you ever were before. You will come out better on the other side. And we're still in the middle of a pandemic. We're still in the middle of different variants and different issues. But here's what I do know. We are strong. We are sweet. We are kind fellowship. We have a vision to impact people's lives. We have had the opportunity to make a difference in people's lives this year, and we're going to do it again next year. We know God has something in store for it. That vision that burns inside of my heart is the same vision I want to grab hold of yours as well, because what God has in store for us is absolutely amazing, powerful, meaningful, and significant. Now, let's think about that, because when you get to Habakkuk, you realize something. Here's the story of a minor prophet writing at a very difficult time. There's very little hopefulness going on. Habakkuk didn't even understand the times he lives in some way. And so as a result, he records this message that we get as one of the minor prophets that really does shape our understanding of vision, because in the book of Habakkuk, we find some verses related to vision that are some of the most quoted and most powerful of the entire Bible. So today, as you think about that, begin to think about your own life and what kind of vision God has for you, because here's what you realize. In order to have a clear vision, in order to experience vision the way God intended, first of all, you have to understand it. You got to know what it is God wants to do through you. Secondly, you got to live it. And it's not just understanding, it's living it out. And finally, it's sharing it with others. Share it with others. So think about the vision statement of One Heart Church that was birthed 16 years ago. That we would be authentic followers of Jesus, committed to changing the world. What have we done? We've had the privilege of going all over the world, making a difference. We've had the privilege of going across the street and making a difference. We have the privilege of being able to live out authenticity that people would see in us. And see, the truth is, this year, we're going to look at what it means to be authentic. We're going to look at what it means to be all in for Jesus. And my prayer is that it's going to do something really powerful in your life. So let's begin. What I want to do is shape your thought process, because in chapter 1, you'll see some things in a moment when we come back to it. But you'll notice in verse 5, he makes this statement. Look among, and this is God speaking to him. Look among the nations, observe, be astonished, wonder, because I'm doing something in your days you would not believe it if you were told. So all of a sudden, out of what's going on inside of Habakkuk, the Lord says, get ready, be astonished, be amazed, because I'm about to do something that has great, great impact on you. Chapter 2, notice what, here are the verses on vision. I will stand, verse 1, I will stand on my guard post, station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will speak to me and how I may reply when I'm reproved. Then the Lord answered me and said, record the vision and scribe it on tablets that the one who reads it may run. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. It hastens towards a goal. It will not fail. It will not fail. Now, look on over if you would, because I want you to see, if you would, in chapter 3. Notice what he says in verse 2. Lord, I have heard the report about you and I fear. O Lord, revive the work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. Wow. You see, today as we dive into this text, I believe God's going to say something to your heart. He's going to speak to you about how you view life, how you respond to circumstances, how you live out your convictions, what kind of commitment you make to being able to experience what God intends. And I'm going to tell you, when it all unfolds, what I believe something amazing is going to happen in all of our hearts and lives. I'm so committed to it that I'm praying for it. I'm believing God for it. And I know he's going to do it. We are all in for Jesus in 2022. So let's look at this and let's dive into this passage. I want to show you three very distinctive things that stand out of this text that I think will be very helpful to you. First of all, in chapter 1, you notice that the perspective that is brought to the table is certainly not one that is encouraging. Look, if you would, at chapter 1, verse 2. How long, O Lord, will I call for help and you will not hear? I cry out to you violence, yet you do not save. Why do you make me see iniquity and cause me to look on wickedness? Yet destruction and violence are before me. Strife exists, contentions arise. Therefore the law is ignored, justice is never upheld. The wicked surround the righteous. Therefore justice comes out perverted. So when you read this, you realize, okay, wait a minute. It doesn't sound like Habakkuk's having a good day. Sound like he's having a really difficult day, and his perspective is skewed by his immediate circumstances. And what I want you to see, first of all, is this. When it comes to our perspective projects direction. In other words, if I look at things a certain way, and I allow that to control which way I'm going, it's going to move me either towards God's best or away from God's best, either towards his will or away from his will. You got to realize that your perspective, if you have a perspective that the glass is half full or half empty, it's going to define how you look at life. So let's look at this passage and just kind of see. So because perspective really does help us think through some things. First of all, if circumstances rule, then convictions will falter. In other words, if we allow some circumstance, some situation to get in the way of God's best for our life, then what happens? Our convictions begin to falter because they're based in a perspective that's skewed by what's going on around us. All right? Be wise. You notice that how skewed the perspective was of Habakkuk as he writes here in chapter 1. Thank God we get to chapter 3 and we see that God is doing something. And he, at the end of chapter 3, when you get there, you realize he says something really profound. It's been quoted and books have been written about this particular verse. And you'll see it in the last verses of chapter 3. But the second thing you see is not only do our circumstances guide us, but if we misunderstand his plan, if we don't understand what it is he wants to do in our life, we'll misunderstand his ways. You see, sometimes we find ourselves zeroing in on something that's irrelevant when we could be zeroing in on what is absolutely irreplaceable. And that is that God has a way to take the most unique moments of our lives and do something really good inside of us. We just have to be wise enough to understand that he has a plan that supersedes ours. One final thing I want you to see out of chapter 1 that really does shape our thought process, because when you get into it, you get to verse 12 of chapter 1, and you ask the question, are you not from everlasting, O Lord my God, my Holy One? We will not die. You, O Lord, have appointed them to judge, and you O rock, have established them to correct. Your eyes are too pure to approve evil, and you cannot look on wickedness with favor. Why do you look with favor? Why do you look with favor on those who deal treacherously? Why are you silent with the wicked? Swallow up those more righteous than they? And what's happening to him? You see, what's happening to him is simply this. He was not willing to wait for God to speak. And here's what I want you to see. If we wait for him to speak, we'll find understanding. We'll see what it is he's trying to show us. And for Habakkuk, he was trying to see everything based on a perspective that pushed his direction away from God's best. May it never be said of us that our perspective was based in circumstances, our perspective was based in our own plan, our perspective was based in something that we heard versus what God speaks to us. May we understand our perspective is key. Second thing I want you to see is this, and I want you to kind of think through this very precisely. Because the second thing in chapter 2 are the verses that have been quoted over and over and over again. And it's here that it has to do with positioning our lives in the right place. Because he said, I'll stand on a rampart. I will wait to see what he's going to say to me. And see, so the second thing I want you to see is this. We have to be willing to position our lives inside his vision. Because inside his vision, it will lead to victory. You see, you position your life in beside what God has for you. And I'm telling you, you get victorious. You know, I look back across the span of the years of ministry, and here's what I know. Vision moves hearts. Vision is what God has for us. And listen carefully. May it never be said of us that we become victim to some circumstance, some situation, even some pandemic. May we instead be victorious. And so let's look at what he says here, because he says some very profound thing that I think will be helpful to you, and I hope will be a blessing to you. All right? Chapter 2, you realize he starts out by saying, I will stand on my guard post and station myself on the rampart, and I will watch to keep and see what he'll say to me. So the first thing he says to us very clearly is this. In obedience, stand and watch. Just be willing to stop and go, you know what? I'm going to see what it is God has for me. Look on, though. Because he also says to us that you can recognize that he will speak to you personally. What Habakkuk says here, and to see what he will speak to me. His personal connection point to our journey of faith is such a profound thing. A third thing you see here when it relates to this whole idea of positioning, all right? So remember, perspective does one thing. Positioning does another. The third thing I want you to see is this, that when you get down to it, you have to listen for instructions. And when he gives those instructions, follow them. You'll notice how he responds, latter part of verse 1, and how I may reply when I am reproved. Then the Lord answered me and said, record the vision, inscribe it on tablets, that the one who reads it may run. You see, here's what God knew. If you got it burned in your heart, a vision that comes from him, you're going to run with it. You're going to do something with it that is absolutely astonishing. Look on, though. The fourth thing I want you to see is this. His vision will always lead to victory. Because what he says here, verse 3, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. It hastens towards a goal, and it will not fail. Though it tarries, wait for it will certainly come. It will not delay. God has something for us. He has something profound. It will not delay. It'll come at us in the exact time he intends. And today, as you think about that, what would it be like if God just spoke to your heart and said, you know, this is what I want you to do. These are the steps I want you to take. These are the places I want you to go. These are the words I want you to share. These are the moments I want you to experience. What happens? I can tell you what happens. Your life gets on fire for God. And listen carefully. No circumstance, no situation should disposition you in such a place where the fire doesn't burn inside of you to accomplish his will. Let it guide you towards what he wants to accomplish. I'm fired up about what it is God wants to do in each one of our lives. One final thing is this, and you'll notice in verse 4, you can't miss this. Behold, as for the proud one, his soul is not right within him, but the righteous will live by his faith. And here's what I want you to see that Habakkuk records. Avoid the enemy of vision, which is pride. When you start getting proud, thinking, you know, I've got every answer, I've got every issue. No, listen, trust him with all your heart, the Bible says. Yield to him. Watch him guide you. Today, as you think about that, are you positioned in the right place to experience his vision for your life? If you are, this year is going to be an amazing year. One final thing I want you to see today is, first of all, you understand your perspective is key, and then you position yourself, and then prayer. The third and final thing I want you to see is this. Prayer is the key to following God. I mean, it is the key to everything. Look, if you would, in verse 1 of chapter 3, because here he begins to pray. And he begins to pray, and you read it in verse 2, Lord, I've heard the reports about you, and I fear, oh Lord, revive your work in the midst of the years. And he goes on to talk about all the ways in which he's trusting God to do what only he can do, all right? So by the time you begin to understand, he is really praying out and crying out to God. That's why at verse 16, he said, I heard and my inward parts trembled. At the sound, my lips quivered, decay entered my bones, and in my place I tremble because I must wait quietly for the day of distress, for the people to arise who will invade us. So here's what he knew. It was inevitable. There was a consequence to their disobedience, to their sin. And his prayer, though, brought him back to mercy. And, uses that really profound statement, in wrath, remember mercy. So when prayer is the key to everything, let's think about this for a second, because I think it's really important for us to not miss this. First of all, the important thing is to realize fear is a dangerous emotion. If you allow fear to guide you, you're going to be messed up on everything. Fear is just going to get control of you. And it's interesting watching during this season how many people have allowed fear to steal their joy, fear to steal their direction, fear to steal their hope. Don't let it happen to you. The second thing I want you to see is this. And it's interesting how Habakkuk records this. He asked for revival. And here's what you and I need to do. We need to ask him to revive what is dormant in our lives. If our prayer life is not on fire, reinstitute inside of us a desire to pray. If our Bible study is not focused on him, if our sharing our faith is not as vibrant as it needs to be, as our witness is cold and needs to be hot, may God do all that in us. Ask him to revive. In other words, to do something in us that only he can do. Final thing I want you to see is this, when you look at this, and that is, you see his mercy in everything. And that's why when you get down to the very last verses, verse 18, notice what he says. Yet I will exult in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. And he's made my feet like hinds' feet and makes me walk on high places. Here's what I want you to realize. God has some high places in store for you. He has some places that he has in store for you that are completely linked to your vision for life. And so you look at this, you go, wait a minute now. So if I see his mercy in everything and I have a vision and I can seek the Lord, what happened to us? You come to an application. And here's what you discover. You learn how to rejoice in your salvation and live in his strength. That's exactly what he says in these last verses. Learn how to rejoice in your salvation and live in his strength. Today, as you think about that, will you accept the challenge of a great future? Will you look at your life and go, you know what? What I really want more than anything else is to know that God has a plan and that something vibrant and dynamic can happen inside of me. Listen, it can. All you have to do is let him give you a vision for life. Stand in the right place. Listen for the right instructions. Be willing to write it down when he speaks to you. And as a result, just don't get proud when he does. You do that, you are going to get a glimpse in the future that's more profound than you ever imagined. What an exciting year this is for me personally. I'm thrilled. I'm thrilled because it's the opportunity to be able to share with you that God has something in store for your life that's amazing. He wants to do something inside of you that changes everything about how you view the future. Let's pray. Let's ask the Lord to speak to your heart just like he's speaking to mine. Father, thank you. That vision that leads to victory motivates our hearts to experience so many profound things. I ask you in Jesus' name to do something inside of the hearts of every person who's watching this video. May this message resonate with them. May they realize, like Habakkuk, that he had to listen to what God said. I'm about to do something that even if you had thought of it or asked for it, you wouldn't imagine what I'm going to do. You see, God's at work. He's at work in our lives. He's at work in our hearts. We will stand in the right place and we will watch what you have to say to us because we trust you, Lord. May you guide us and may you bless us, for we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, what a joy it is to welcome you into a new year. It's an exciting time to be able to reflect on God's word and how it speaks to it. I am excited more than ever about what the future holds, and I know he is going to guide you in a beautiful way as well. God bless you. Have an amazing new year. Happy New Year to you.